Hello friends, today's topic is the anatomy of the palate, which includes the hard and the soft palate. The palate, as you know, is a partition between the roof of the mouth and the floor of the nasal cavity. So it is a partition here, this is the partition between the nasal cavity and the oral cavity. So it is a partition between the roof of the mouth or the oral cavity. Roof of the mouth is the mouth or the oral cavity. On the top is the roof. Okay. And the floor of the nasal cavity. This is the nasal cavity and this forms the floor. The same structure forms the roof for the oral cavity and floor for the nasal cavity. So this partition, which is both muscular as well as bony, as well as even aponeurotic. So this partition will be dividing, separating the nasal cavity from the oral cavity. So this is called as the palate. It is bounded both from before backwards and from side to side by the alveolar arch. So we will see the alveolar arches, so which will be forming in the front as well as from the sides. Okay, it is the bony part. It consists of two parts. One is the hard palate in the anterior two-thirds, and there is the soft palate in the posterior one-third. So the anterior two-thirds, this large bigger part, this forms the hard palate, which will be mainly bony, and the posterior part, this is the one-third of the remaining palate that will be soft because it will be mainly muscular as well as aponeurotic. Okay, so this is the palate here, which consists of the hard palate and the soft palate. So this picture again is showing this the palate separating the nasal cavity from the oral cavity. It forms this palate from the roof of the oral cavity and floor of the nasal cavity. So there is the hard palate and behind we have the soft palate. Coming to the hard palate, it presents a bony framework formed by a pair of palatine process of the maxilla in the front as well as a pair of horizontal part of the palatine bones behind. Let me show you here the picture showing you the hard palate. This is the hard palate whole thing seen from below. This is the hard palate seen from the oral cavity. Okay, so these are the two palatine process of the maxilla, a pair of means two bones on either side. These are the palatine process of the maxilla, a pair of palatine process of maxilla. Then behind we have the horizontal plate of the palatine bone. These are again a pair. So totally four bones here, two palatine process of the maxilla and two the horizontal plate of the palatine bone. So this will form the hard palate. It is made up of four bones, a pair of palatine process of the maxilla in the front and a pair of horizontal parts of the palatine bones behind. Anterolateral margins continue with the alveolar arch. Let's see the alveolar arch. This bony projection here, which forms a U-shaped structure into which the teeth are fixed. This arch is called as the bony arch is called as the alveolar arch, into which the teeth are fixed. Okay, so this is the alveolar arch. So anterolateral margins anteriorly as well as laterally. As you can see here, this is the anterior part and this is the lateral part. Anterolaterally, so it will continue with the alveolar arch, and posterior margin will be for the soft palate. Here this is the posterior margin. Okay. Till here is this whole thing is the hard palate. Behind that will be the soft palate, which is not shown here in this picture. Soft palate has not been shown, only the hard palate will see. Soft palate will be attached to this posterior margins. Okay. So anterior margin and lateral margins are by the alveolar arch, and posterior margin is free where the muscular part or the soft part of the palate will be attached. Superior surface will be the floor of the nasal cavity covered by the ciliated columnar epithelium of the nasal cavity, as you saw behind before. So the superior surface of this hard palate, if you imagine the hard palate, the superior surface, which will be the nasal cavity, will be lined by the respiratory epithelium, which is nothing but the ciliated columnar epithelium of the nasal cavity. Then the inferior surface, it is facing the oral cavity. So this will form the roof of the oral cavity, and it is lined by the same type of epithelium which is lining the oral cavity, that is keratinized stratified squamous epithelium. So superior surface is lined by the ciliated columnar epithelium because it is facing the nasal cavity, and the flow or the lower surface, which form the roof of the oral cavity, is lined by the keratinized stratified squamous epithelium with numerous mucus secreting palatine glands in the posterior half. You can see mucus secreting palatine glands. Okay, so here you can see here, this is the hard palate covered by a thick layer of mucous membrane, which is the mucous membrane of the oral cavity, which is lined by the stratified squamous epithelium. Okay, and here you can see this is the hard palate. Now behind that is the soft palate. This is the soft palate here. So this is the aponeurotic cord, and this is the muscular part behind. We'll talk about this later. So this is the hard palate in the front, and this is the soft palate behind. So here also you can see, so here will be the hard palate. This is the alveolar arch with the two sockets are there with the teeth are fixed, and here is the hard palate. Okay, and the posterior margin here is free, where we can imagine the soft palate. The hard palate lies at the level of axis vertebrae in the adult. If you see here, this is at the level of almost at the axis vertebra. This is the axis is the second vertebra. Atlas is the first vertebra, axis is the second vertebra. So it is lying at the level of the axis vertebra, that is the second cervical vertebra, between the skull and the atlas vertebra in case of infants, it is much more higher between the skull, the base of the skull, and the first vertebra, that is the atlas vertebra. Now, if you see this same hard palate again from below with mucous membrane, now here the bone cannot be seen because it is lined by the stratified squamous epithelium. Now you can see some of the important features here. The mucous periosteum presents a median raphe which ends in front in the small papilla overlying the incisive fossa. If you see here is the incisive fossa, and there is a median raphe here. Median raphe extending all the way even to the soft palate. Okay, so this is called as the median raphe. In the front, it will end in a small fossa here. This is called as the incisive fossa. Okay, several transverse folds extend bilaterally from the anterior part of the raphe and make the lower surface of the lower surface corrugated. Okay, so if you can see here, this lower surface here, especially in the anterior half, you can see that it is corrugated, or you can see a lot of folds, in uneven folds can be seen. Okay, so several transverse folds extend bilaterally from the anterior part of the raphe and make the lower surface corrugated. As you can see here, these are called as the palatine Gouge folds. Okay, so as you can see in this picture, I mentioned between this part is the hard palate, and behind this is the soft palate made up of the muscles. Okay, now coming to the soft palate, it is a fibromusculoglandular curtain covered by mucus which hangs from the posterior margin of the hard palate. As you can see here, this is the hard palate, as I said, behind it is the soft palate. Okay, so it is partly it is fibrous, partly it is muscular, as well as partly it is glandular. Okay, and this is the fibromusculoglandular curtain covered by the mucus which hangs from the posterior margin of the hard palate. As we have seen, from the posterior margin will be hanging the soft palate. Okay, the anterior two-thirds of this soft palate is fibrous, middle one-third is muscular, and the posterior one-third is glandular. This is how it is divided into anterior one-third, middle one-third, and posterior one-third. Anterior one-third will be fibrous, middle one third will be muscular and the posterior one third will be glandular. It extends backwards and downwards between the nasal and oral parts of the pharynx. As we have seen, the pharynx has three parts. Behind the nasal cavity, this is called as the nasopharynx. Behind the oral cavity, this is called as the oropharynx. And behind the larynx is called as the laryngopharynx. So this soft palate will be separating the nasopharynx from the oropharynx. Okay. It moves, its movement help in the speech, deglutition as well as blowing. It is a very important structure which will help whenever it will start moving, whenever we speak. So it will be going up and down during swallowing as well as during blowing. Okay, the structure will move and we can totally close the nasopharynx from the oropharynx. Okay. Parts, it is quadrilateral in shape and has two surfaces and four borders. As you saw before, it has two surfaces. The two surfaces are, one is the anterior surface and the second one is the posterior surface. As the picture indicates, so this is how it looks like. It is almost all bleak. So this will be the anterior surface and behind will be the posterior surface. And it has four margins, so four borders. Two lateral borders, one is the anterior border which you attach and posterior border which is free. Four borders and two surfaces. This is the anterior surface and behind will be the posterior surface. So we'll talk about them one by one. The anterior surface is concave, directed downwards and forward, and presents a median raphe. As we saw, median raphe not only is covering the hard palate, but it continues into the soft palate in the midline. So that's what is called as median raphe. Posterior surface is convex, directed upwards and backwards from the anterior boundary of the pharyngeal isthmus and on sides connected to the tubal elevation by the salpingo-palatine fold. Let me show you later the pictures. Okay, and there are four borders, upper border, lateral border, as you can see here. So these are the upper border, two lateral borders and the lower border. So now we are talking about the anterior surface, which is, as you can see here, this is the anterior surface here, this is the soft palate, this is the hard palate here, which is bony, as you can see here. Here this is muscular part, this is the soft palate. So anterior surface is concave here, and you can see the extending of the median raphe. Okay, and directed downward forwards in direction. Coming to the posterior surface, it is convex, directed backwards and upward. As you can see here, the posterior surface, which is directed upwards, backwards towards the nasopharynx. Okay, forms anterior boundary of the pharyngeal isthmus. What is pharyngeal isthmus? There is a small opening here between the oropharynx, the nasopharynx and the oropharynx. So that opening is called as the pharyngeal isthmus. And on sides connected to the tubal elevation by the salpingo-palatine fold. What is tubal elevation? Here this is the station tube or auditory tube which is there. Beside that there is a fold here, fold overlying the palatopharyngeal sphincter. Okay. So this is called as the salpingo-palatine fold. Now coming to the four borders, the upper border attached to the posterior margin of the hard palate. So the upper border is the upper border which is attached to the hard palate. Okay, to which it is connected. Okay, so this will be attached. The lateral borders contains with the wall of the pharynx. Lateral border will be contains with the wall of the pharynx. As you can see here, this is the in the nasal cavity, this is the oral cavity. Here is the soft palate. The picture seen from behind. If you see from here, if you see from behind like this, this is how it looks like. So here you can see this is the soft palate, and at the sides, if you can see here, these are the margins of the soft palate which are attached and going towards the sides. Okay. So they are contained with the wall of the pharynx. The lower border will be free and presents a median conical projection called as ulna. And the posterior border is free, okay, and the center there is a projection. This is called as ulna. Okay, so here you can see here. So, so these are the two lateral margins. This is the anterior border or the upper border which is attached to the hard palate, and the posterior border is free, okay, and it keeps it shows an elevation as called as uvula. And you can see here, this is the median trapezoid, which is extending all the way from the hard palate even to the soft palate. Now, composition of the soft palate, what is it made up of? It is made up of the palatine aponeurosis. We'll see later pictures which will show the palatine aponeurosis. It is nothing but the aponeurosis of the muscles, palatine muscles. And there are five pairs of palatine muscles. We'll study them also. Then there are nerves and vessels within them, as well as palatine glands. These are the four structures which will be present in the soft palate. So it will have the palatine aponeurosis, five pairs of palatine muscles, nerves and vessels, as well as palatine glands. So this is the main composition of the soft palate. Mainly it is muscular palatine muscles here, five muscles. Coming to the covering of this soft palate, it is mucous membrane. It is lined by non-carotenoid stratified squamous epithelium, just like that of the oral cavity. Even for the hard palate, as the lower surface, the oral part of the hard palate, as well as even the soft palate, is covered by the non-carotenoid stratified squamous epithelium. Coming to the palatine aponeurosis, what is this palatine aponeurosis? As we said, this is the composition. It is a fibrous framework of soft palate where all the palatine muscles are attached. Aponeurosis, as you know, aponeurosis means it is nothing but the thinning of the muscle. All the five muscles will get thinned up and they become fibrous in nature, and they form a aponeurosis. This is called a palatine aponeurosis. It is a fibrous framework of soft palate where all the palatine muscles are attached. The aponeurosis is expanded tendon of the insertion of the, mainly from the tensor like palatine muscle. Along with that, the other muscles also get inserted to that. But anyhow, the main muscle which forms this aponeurosis is the tensor like palatine muscle. Coming to the muscles of the soft palate, which are those muscles? The first muscle is called a tensor velli palatini. So this is the tensor velli palatini. This is the muscle. The second muscle is behind that. This is called as the levator velli palatini. So here is the soft palate here. This is the hard palate here, the soft palate. So you can see two muscles from above, tensor velli palatini, levator velli palatini. Then we have a muscle within the, this is called a small muscle called as the musculus uvulae, which forms the uvula. Then we have the palatoglossus, this is the palatoglossus muscle here. Then we have the palatopharyngeus muscle. So these are the five muscles. One is the levator velli palatini, this is the tensor velli palatini, levator velli palatini. Then we have the palatoglossus, palatopharyngeus, as well as musculus uvulae. These are the five muscles which form the soft palate. Now coming to each muscle. Okay, the first muscle, the most important muscle, is the tensor velli palatini. This is a thin triangular sheet of muscle lying lateral to the medial pterygoid plate, pterygoid tympanic tube, and levator palatine muscle. And its origin is from the scaphoid fossa. Let me show you. So this is the picture showing you the base of the skull. This is the hard palate, the four bones, and behind that will be the soft palate, as you know. Okay. So this muscle, the tensor velli palatini, will be taking origin from the scaphoid fossa, sulcus tubae, as well as the spine of the spinae. Where are they? The first one is the scaphoid fossa. This is the scaphoid fossa. The scaphoid fossa on the spinal bone for the attachment of the tensor velli palatini. Then we have the sulcus tubae here, as well as we have the spine of the spinal bones. Spine of spinal will be here. Okay, so here will be the spine of spinal. Either side here. Okay, so this is the origin of this muscle called as the tensor velli palatini. The anterolateral wall of the cartilaginous part of the auditory tube, as well as it also takes origin from the cartilage. This is the auditory tube here, cartilaginous portion of the
ringotic mammary tube or auditory tube or gestation tube, whatever you call it as. So this is the cartilaginous part. So it will be taking origin from the scaphoid fossa, sulcus tubae, spinal spinal bone, as well as the anterolateral wall of the cartilaginous part of the auditory tube. The fibers converge and end in a tendon which winds around the pterygoid hamblus and expand into palatine apophysis. Where is the pterygoid hamblus? This is the pterygoid hamblus. So the origin of this muscle will be from here, and then it goes like this, goes around the pterygoid hamblus and then hangs downwards. Let me show you. So here you can see here the origin of the muscle has been taken place. So this is the auditory tube. So then it is going down, and then it goes toward the pterygoid hamblus, and then it becomes an apophysis. It is called as the palatine apophysis. So mainly formed by the tensile bone like palatine. So, okay. So this is the origin of this muscle, tensile bone like palatine. Then the insertion through the palatine apophysis to the posterior border of the hard palate. As you can see, it will go down here and get attached to the posterior border of the hard palate. This is the posterior border, and this is the posterior border of the hard palate. So this is the origin insertion of this muscle. Now coming to the action. As the name itself indicates, it is tensor. So it tensors the soft palate. Whenever this muscle contracts, it tensors the soft palate and elevates. When is this important? Active in deglutition, that is swallowing, where it depresses the soft palate, thereby pushing the bolus of the food against the tongue, aiding its descent into the oropharynx. So the tongue will ascend upwards, as well as the soft palate descend downwards, and both will meet and press the food and bolus and push it behind into the oropharynx. Okay. It also pulls soft palate to the same side. So this is the function of the tensor like palatine. So this is the muscle coming here, pterygoid hamblus, and this is the palatine apophysis. This is the attachment, and it is the same. This is the whole thing is apophysis. Now coming to the second muscle, levator like palatine. It is a cylindrical muscle situated lateral to the posterior nasal aperture. And the origin of this muscle is from the inferior aspect of the apex of the petrous part of the temporal bone in front of the carotid canal. So let me show you again. So here, this is the carotid canal. Okay. So in front of the carotid canal, just somewhere here, will be the, so here. Okay. So sorry, here. So this is the carotid canal on either side. Sorry. This is the carotid canal on either side, as you can see here. So just in front of the carotid canal, this is the roughening of the petrous part of the temporal bone for the attachment of the levator like palatine. So this area is the origin for this muscle, which is the levator like palatine, just in front of the carotid canal, and also a sheath covering around the carotid canal, in the carotid sheath. Okay. So it will be from the inferior aspect of the apex of the petrous part of the temporal bone. So as you saw, this is the petrous part of the temporal bone in front of the carotid canal, as well as the carotid sheath partly, and inferior medial aspect of the cartilaginous part of the auditory tube. And in front we can have this part here. This is the cartilaginous portion of the independent tube or the auditory tube or the phrygotic tube. So it will take origin from this area. Okay. For carotid sheath in front, this is for the petrous part, as well as for the cartilaginous part of the auditory tube. So this is the origin of this muscle. Okay. It forms the bulk of the soft palate. So it is mainly on the bulk of the soft palate muscular part. The fibers pass above the upper border of the superior constrictor through the sinus of Malgrat-Mé, and they get inserted to the palatine apophysis. Now you can see here. So here, this is the palatine apophysis, which is formed by the, as we saw, tensor levator palatine. Now this is the levator palatine, which is coming down from behind from here. So, the part of the auditory tube from behind. So this is the datum cerebral apparatus which is going in front of the auditory tube. So this is going from behind and get inserted to the palatine aponeurosis. Palatine aponeurosis insertion into the palatine aponeurosis. Actions, as the name indicates, levator. So it elevates the soft palate and closes the pharyngeal isthmus during swallowing. Whenever you swallow, this soft palate will move and go and closes the pharyngeal isthmus. So the food particle doesn't enter the nasal cavity or the nasopharynx. So during swallowing, thereby preventing the entry of food into the nasopharynx from the oropharynx. And also during the production of the explosive consonants in speech. So at that time, whenever you are making explosive consonants, then at that time also it will close. Okay. Now coming to the third muscle, that is the musculus uvulae. It is a small muscle which is present within the uvula. Okay. Origin, posterior edge of the hard palate near the posterior nasal spine, posterior surface of the palatine aponeurosis. So it will taking origin from the palatine aponeurosis. It runs backwards through the palatine aponeurosis and splits into two parts. Insertion, it will be into the submucous tissue of the base of the uvula. Okay. Action, elevation and retraction of the uvula. So it helps in the movement of the uvula. Small muscle present in the uvula, taking origin from the palatine aponeurosis as well as the hard palate. Okay. So here you can see this is the muscle, musculus uvulae going in the front, and it is divided into two parts as we mentioned before. Okay. So whenever it contracts, it will move upwards and downwards. Now coming to the fourth muscle, that is called as the palatoglossus. As the name indicates, palatoglossus, it takes origin from the palate and ends in the glossus. Glossus means tongue. It is a small fasciculus which arises from the oral surface of the palatine aponeurosis and lies to the palatoglossal arch. Lies deep to the palatoglossal arch. So here you can see here, this is the palatoglossus muscle, beginning from the palatine aponeurosis going into the tongue. Okay. It is directed downwards, forwards and laterally in front of the tonsillar sinus to reach the side of the tongue at the junction of the anterior two-thirds and the posterior one-third. So it is going and getting inserted at the junction between the anterior two-thirds and posterior one-third of the tongue. Okay. Insertion, some fibers go to the side of the tongue, few fibers enter the substance of the tongue and intermingle with the transverse lingulae. As you know, there are different muscles, different types of muscles. One of the muscles of the tongue will be the transverse muscles. They are longitudinal, upper longitudinal, lower longitudinal, transverse. These are the intrinsic muscles. So it gets inserted into the transverse lingulae between the anterior junction between the anterior two-thirds and posterior one-third of the tongue. What is the action of this muscle? It elevation of the tongue, root of the tongue. So whenever this muscle contracts, it either pulls the palate downwards, or mainly it will help in the elevation of the tongue. Whenever you are swallowing, it helps in the elevation. Approximate the palatoglossal arch, closing the oropharyngeal isthmus, thereby closing the oral cavity from the oropharynx during deglutition. So you can see in this picture, so here is the palatoglossus muscle. So these are palatine tonsils, and deep to that there are two muscles here. One is the palatopharyngeus and here is the palatoglossus. So wherever the muscle contracts, this palatoglossus which is coming from the palate going to the tongue. So whenever this muscle contracts, it pulls downwards like a shutter. It will come down. Palatoglossus, whenever it contracts, it closes the oral cavity from the oropharynx. Now coming to the fifth muscle, that is the palatopharyngeus, the last muscle in that soft palate, that is the palatopharyngeus. It consists of two fasciculi, anterior and posterior. The anterior thick arises from the hard palate and palatine aponeurosis. Posterior from the palatine aponeurosis. Let me see here. So this is the picture showing you the palatopharyngeus coming from the palate, going into the pharynx. So this is the soft palate here, whole thing up to here. Okay, so there is a muscle coming from here. So this is the palatal pharyngeus. Okay, so anterior, there are two fasciculi, anterior posterior. Anterior arises from the hard palate and the palatine neurosis. Both from the hard palate as well as the palatine neurosis. And the posterior. And the posterior will be arising mainly from the palatine aponeurosis. Between the two fasciculi is the levator palati. So this muscle is divided into two parts by the levator palati. Here is the levator palati. This is the levator palati, levator palati. This muscle will be passing between these two muscles. Okay, so here this is the levator palati, and here we have the palatal pharyngeus. Two parts of palato, levator palati will be passing. Between the two fasciculi is the levator palati. The fibers are directed downwards behind the tonsils. Some of the fibers are lost in the pharynx, while other fibers along with the stylopharyngeus, selpingopharyngeus are attached to the posterior border of the lamina of the thyroid cartilage. And this will be one of the muscles of the larynx. There are two types of muscles of the larynx. Longitudinal as well as the constrictors. Along the longitudinal, palatal pharyngeus is one of the muscles which will be not only the muscle of the palate but also the muscle of the pharynx. So this is called as palatopharyngeus muscle. So what is the action? Pulls the wall of the pharynx forwards, upwards, and medially towards midline during swallowing. So whenever you are swallowing, so this muscle will pull the larynx upwards, forwards, so that when the food is passing, it doesn't have to enter the larynx, but it will go into the laryngopharynx, from there into the esophagus. Okay, so it prevents the food from entering the larynx. So it will pull the larynx upwards. So this is the palatopharyngeus muscle. So these are all the muscles here again. Okay, so this is the tensorvilla palatini, the levatorvilla palatini, the palatopharyngeus, palatopharyngeus. So now here, you can see here, this is the neutral position of the soft palate. So both the food particles are entering as well as the person is respiring. Both air and the food are entering. So if you want to take deep breath at that time, this soft palate will totally close this oropharynx, and then the air is entering into the larynx. And when you are swallowing, this soft palate will move and go behind and close the pharyngeal isthmus, so that food can enter instead of from the oropharynx into the esophagus, from the laryngopharynx into the esophagus, and it prevents food from entering the nasopharynx. Okay. So this is in case of children, where the breastfed child is both taking the milk as well as the milk is here. He is also taking the milk at the same time also perspiring. Okay. So that is also possible. During sneezing, a blast of air is divided and is directed through the nasal cavity, oral cavity, without damaging the narrow nose. So during sneezing, this soft palate helps in dividing the blast of air into the nasal cavity, oral cavity, without damaging the nose, not putting all the pressure on the nose. During swallowing, pharyngeal isthmus is closed by the action of the levator palati and the palatopharyngeus, thereby preventing entry of food into the nasopharynx from the oropharynx. As we saw, here you can see this picture. So this is the picture showing you this soft palate has totally closed the pharyngeal isthmus so that the food doesn't enter into the nasopharynx. During speech, oropharyngeal isthmus is open or closed to varying degree to correct the modulation of the speech and for the correct pronunciation of various consonants. So whenever during speech, this soft palate will be moving up and down to make the correct pronunciation. Whenever we are speaking, not only the tongue, but even the even the soft palate help in the correct pronunciation of various types of words and sounds and other things. Okay. Coming to the nerve supply, all the muscles of the soft palate are supplied by the cranial part of the accessory nerve. So all the muscles of the soft palate are supplied by the cranial part of the accessory nerve. Okay, through the pharyngeal plexus. Okay, from the pharyngeal plexus, except the tensor villi palatini, all are supplied by the accessory part of the cranial part of the accessory nerve through the pharyngeal plexus, except the tensor villi palatini. So what about the tensor villi palatini? It is supplied by the trunk of the mandibular nerve through the otic ganglion. Now coming to the secretum motor, the pregnomic fibers arises from the superior salivary nucleus and pass successively through the facial, then greater protrusor, nerve of the pterygoid canal, as well as laid into the pterygopalatine ganglion. Post ganglion fibers reach the palatine gland via the greater and lesser palatine nerves that we show you. Sensory, through the greater lesser palatine, as well as long sphenopalatine, as well as the glossopharyngeal nerve. As well as the special sensory, there are some taste buds there. Okay, so this will also carry the special sensation, the taste sensation from the oral surface of the soft palate are covered by the glossopharyngeal as well as the lesser palatine nerves. Okay, now coming to this picture showing you the superior salivary nucleus for the sensory, even secretory motor here. Okay, the preganglion fibers arises from the superior salivary nucleus and pass through the successively through the facial, then the greater protrusor, nerve of the pterygoid canal, and right into the pterygopalatine ganglion. If you see here, so this is the superior salivary nucleus passing through the facial nerve. Then there is this nerve. This is called as the greater protrusor nerve, and then it continues into the nerve of the pterygoid canal. Is also called as the median nerve or the nerve of the pterygoid canal. Then it relays here. Okay, this is called the pterygopalatine ganglion. Okay, led into the pterygopalatine ganglion. The postganglion fibers reach the palatine glands via the greater and lesser palatine nerves. Now small fibers will be passing down here, and then they will be divided into greater as well as lesser palatine nerves. The greater and lesser palatine. So this is the whole root of the filling of the secretory fibers. Okay, from the superior salivary nucleus, pass through the facial nerve, then through this nerve, this is the greater protrusor nerve, then the nerve of the pterygoid canal, which is also part of the median nerve. Then it relays here. The secondary fibers will carry down through and supply the soft and hard palate through the greater and lesser palatine. Greater palatine will be supplying the hard palate, and the lesser palatine will be carrying the fibers from the soft palate. Okay. Coming to the general sensory, through the greater as well as lesser palatine, long sphenopalatine, and the glossopharyngeal nerve. Special sensation. The taste sensation from the oral surface of the soft palate are covered by the glossopharyngeal as well as the lesser palatine. As we have already seen, this is the lesser palatine and here is the greater palatine. Okay. So this is the same ganglion here. So you also can see. So this is the pterygopalatine ganglion. Pterygopalatine ganglion. The side here also. So here also you can see this big pterygopalatine ganglion. So here it is giving fiber palatine to the palatine canal. These fibers are coming and divided into greater palatine as well as lesser palatine nerves. Lesser palatine, the greater palatine will be supplying the hard palate, and the lesser palatine will be carrying fibers from the sensation from the soft palate. Here is the nerve of the pterygoid canal. these are the greater and lesser palatinals. Greater palatine will be going over the hard palate, and the lesser palatinals will be coming over the soft palate. Okay. So on the picture again showing the same thing. So here is the pterygopalatine ganglion. And these are palatinals, greater palatine, lesser palatine. Okay. So all glands above the level of the oral fissure innervated by the greater petrosal nerve. So these are the especially the glands are innervated by the greater petrosal nerve, and the glands below will be innervated by the caudate pan supplying the tongue. Okay. So all these pictures are again showing the same thing. So here this is the median nerve of the tegmental nerve. These are the greater and lesser parietal nerves. Coming to the arterial supply. So the arterial supply to the hard and soft palate in general is by the greater palatine branch of the maxillary artery. So maxillary artery is here. So you can see here is the maxillary artery, and it will be giving some branches. So here you can see here some of the branches coming from here. This is the greater palatine artery, which is coming from the maxillary artery. So greater palatine branch of the maxillary artery, which is supplying the mainly the hard palate as well as some part of the soft palate. Then ascending palatine branch of the facial artery. Here is the facial artery. It is the ascending palatine branch of the facial artery. Then palatine branches of the ascending pharyngeal artery. The ascending pharyngeal. There is the ascending, okay, here is the ascending pharyngeal artery, which will be also giving the palatine branches of the ascending pharyngeal artery. Okay, so palatine branches of the ascending the palatine branches of the ascending pharyngeal artery, the ascending palatine branch of the facial artery, so which you saw here, as well as the greater palatine branch of the maxillary artery, the maxillary artery, greater palatine branch. So these are this is the arterial supply to the hard and soft palate. So here you can see the division of these branches. The palatine artery, the greater palatine will be supplying the hard palate, and the lesser palatine the slim of the nerves. Even the arteries are divided into greater and lesser palatine, and the greater palatine, as you can see here, the nerve, this is supplying the hard palate, similarly the artery is also supplying the hard palate. The soft palate is supplied by the lesser palatine artery as well as the nerves. So here again you can see these are the greater palatine, these are the lesser palatine arteries and nerves. Now coming to the venous drainage. Venous drainage drains into the, there is a plexus called as pharyngeal venous plexus. And through that it will drain to the paratonsillar veins. Okay, so you can see here this is a plexus of veins which are in the pharynx, as well as it drains even this hard and soft palate. So the pharyngeal plexus which drains the pharynx also drains the palate. Drains into the pharyngeal venous plexus, with the pharyngeal venous plexus via the paratonsillar veins. Into the paratonsillar veins. Okay. Coming to the lymphatic drainage, drains into the retropharyngeal and upper group of deep cervical lymph nodes. So it will be draining into the deep cervical as well as the retropharyngeal group of retropharyngeal behind the pharynx. Behind pharyngeal behind. Okay, retro means behind, pharyngeal means behind pharynx. Okay, so it is behind the pharynx as well as upper group of deep cervical lymphs, as you can see here. So all these are the deep cervical lymphs which are there, which all the most of the lymphatic drainage from the head and neck and face will be draining into. So this is the deep cervical group. Now coming to the last part, the clinical aspect. The applied aspects. Okay, so how do you check the soft palate is intact or not? Okay, so it is a very simple examination, clinical examination. Muscles of the soft palate may be tested by asking the patient to say ah. Ask him to open his mouth and say ah. When you say ah, the ulna will move in the center, backwards. Normally, the soft palate rises and ulna moves backwards in the midline. It should move in the midline. So if it is moving on either side, then if it is not moving in the midline but on either side, then there is a paralysis on the opposite side. Okay, so this is how you can examine the muscles of the soft palate. Ask the patient to say, open his mouth and say ah. Paralysis of the palatine muscles after diphtheria. So this is common in case of the diphtheria, where the muscles, the nerves supplying the palate will be paralyzed, and especially in case of diphtheria, and that leads to nasal voice as well as regurgitation of the food through the nose when swallowing is attempted. Whenever the person strives to swallow, so because now the palate is not moving properly, it is paralyzed, so the food, instead of going into the esophagus, it will move upwards into the nasal cavity. Regurgitation of food is also possible when the person is trying to swallow. The third is the developmental anomaly that is called as cleft palate. Failure of fusion of the palatine cross of the maxilla with each other in the midline. As you can see here, so the two palates, initially they will be separated, so later they get fused. Okay, if they don't fuse, if there is failure in fusion of the two palatine crosses, then it leads to a defect called as the cleft palate. Here also you can see the cleft palate. Here also you can see the cleft palate. Failure of fusion of the palatine crosses of the maxilla. Sometimes it will continue even to the lip, so then it is called as cleft lip, or it is also called as hair lip, because hair is the rabbit, which will also have similar type of it is natural. Okay, hair will have this kind of lip, so it is called a hair lip. Okay, so cleft lip, so this will lip, this cleft palate will continue around the upper lip also. If there is failure of fusion here, one of the part of the maxilla, then it leads to this congenital defect. This is called as cleft lip. So this cleft lip will be with the cleft palate, so it is associated with the cleft palate, continues into the lip also, cleft lip on one side, either side. Okay. Perforation of the hard palate in case of the tertiary syphilis. Sometimes there can be perforation, especially in case of the third stage, that is the tertiary syphilis, then there can be perforation. In this patient, you can see here the perforation of the hard palate because of the syphilis, condition of syphilis. So these are some of the clinical aspects of this palate. So this is all about the soft and hard palate. If you have any doubts, you can just write down and I'll try to answer. Thank you. Thank you very much.